driving the car. Don't say poo or bollocks. You can say what you want, swear as much as we want on the show.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm gonna say it. Yeah.
Right. Tell you what we'll put on. What about a bit of do you like Van Morrison?
Anything, mate, yeah. Van
Morrison. Nice and low. I don't need my sunglasses on, do I?
No, you look cool enough, mate, you don't need that. I'll tell you what, I got a phone call last night off Pat Barrett.
Oh yeah.
So I went, hey Pat, and he went, it's going to be a really funny conversation this, and I thought, oh God, do you know what I mean? I went, what is it? He went, I've got a racing pigeon. So I went, right, okay. So he said, it's coming the co-op downstairs where the gym is, and he's had pigeons himself when he was a kid, so he's fed it and looked after it and all that, and he's let it out, let it go, like, you know what I mean, anyway, and he's come back, and it's come back to the gym.
So it's so like made its home,
yeah,
there now.
He's got an homing pigeon in the gym.
I don't know. Right, you'll tell me the way, won't you?
Yeah, do it right here, Chris.
Right here. Okay. I'll try and do an intro to this.
Okay.
Good afternoon, this is BBTV. This is In The Car With Episode 3. I'm delighted to say today to be joined by the original B-O-double-B.
Bobby Rimmer. Left ear, Chris.
Left ear. The master of disaster. The Hardwick Hammer.
Yeah,
the
yeah.
Manchester Maverick. So, Bobby Rimmer, you've emigrated to Blackpool, left yeah. the cobblestones of yeah. Manchester yeah. behind. Have yeah. you come into some money?
No, mate, I fell in love.
I fell in love,
didn't I?
It was one of the two.
Yeah, well, you know what? It was a really strange, not a strange story, but when we was in Manchester and Brian was living at the house, he said to me, there's a lady from Blackpool been on the phone.
Straight on,
yeah, straight over, mate, been on the phone. And her son's really ill in hospital, and he's a big fan of ours, so is there any chance we could go and cheer him up with the belts and all that? So I said, yeah, of course, yeah, we'll go, you know what I mean? You know, Brian's like, he's always doing stuff like that, ain't he? Do you know what I mean? So you're going to go second left there, Chris, over there, straight across. So I said, yeah, so we went
straight over there, mate.
So we went to Wivenshaw Hospital. We went down there now. We went to Wivenshaw Hospital and took the belts and met this young kid called Danny Elwood, who's got cystic fibrosis, and his lung had just collapsed. And his mum was there, Sharon, and his sister was there, Chloe. So we just went in, and you know, like, you're telling all the stories and making people laugh, all the boxing stories and stuff like that. And that's where I met Sharon. And that's how I met Sharon.
Brilliant.
You know, unfortunately, Danny and Chloe and Sharon's husband, Mark, was killed on his motorbike years ago, like, you know what I mean? So Sharon was on her own. And then we just kind of hit it off, and we started talking and chatting, and one thing leads to another, and then before I know where I'm up to, I'm walking down Blackpool front, they kiss me fucking quick at them. But yeah, it's great, mate, it's great. It's
they say it happens when you're not looking for
yeah,
it, doesn't it?
And it was. You know what, believe it or not, I'd split up with the kid's mum, and we'd been split up a long time. I was on my own, and I was living in my flat in Openshaw, and I thought, well, this might be it now. You know, I had the gym, I had the flat, I had my pigeons. I thought, this might be it. Anyway, and then all of a sudden, I meet Sharon, and then, you know, before you know where you are, you're in love again.
Yeah. You're at the seaside.
Yep, singing a do what be beside the seaside. But yeah, so it was like really, really strange the way it happened, you know what I mean? But all right, Chris. You know I'm actually shitting myself. You know?
Are you all right though, Bob? I'd heard you not been well. I met you the other day and it was good to hear that you said I'm fine.
The last couple of weeks, the last 2 weeks has been, to say strange, to say a bit strange is is an understatement, you know what I mean? Because we're going where them cars are going down there, Chris.
Yeah.
Because I, for 5 weeks, I've been going to the doctors saying I've got indigestion. Like, real bad indigestion, because I struggle with indigestion. I've had it most of my adult life, so I take medication every day, but I get these pains in my chest, and the medication won't work in. So I went to the doctors up here, got a doctor up here, went to the doctors, and they prescribed me some more medicine, and then it never got any better. It got just got worse and worse and worse, do you know what I mean? It never got any better. So I went to that phone that doctor doc thing where you go in the walking centre, and it was at the Blackpool Vic, the hospital. And I went in last Wednesday morning, well, about 12:30. I had some tests done and all that, and I was sat there talking to the doctor. And the doctor trains at Brian's gym. I've actually trained him in Brian's gym, this doctor. Belting, absolute great doctor. He was waiting for me, blood's coming through back from the lab and all that, and we're just chatting away like you do, and he went, "You've had an heart attack." I went, "When?" He went, "This morning." I went, "Are you joking?" He went, "No, no." He said, you've had an heart attack this morning." So I said, "Well, what happens now?" He said, "Well, you get on the phone and get someone to bring your pyjamas and your slippers." So I said, "What do you mean?" He went, "You're not going home." I thought, you know, like, the farthest thing from my mind, you know what I mean? I'd been doing the pads with the lads and getting pains in my chest, but I'm thinking it's indigestion, so I've been going, "Just hang on a minute, lads." Mm. You know, I was warming Brian up before the Fowler fight, and I thought I had indigestion. I thought it was indigestion, and I had to stop warming him up. And
right, so it'd been like... for a bit, you
yeah,
it's been
for 4 to 5 weeks. Wow. So that we're going to do it right here behind this traffic, Chris. So that was it. I was like, you know, that happened on the Wednesday. So I was in hospital on the Wednesday and the Thursday while they was doing all the tests, of which there's many. And then Friday I went into theatre, and they put that dye up my wrist, you know, to see if any arteries was blocked, and they found 3 arteries that was blocked. So he gave me the option, the surgeon, he gave me one of 2 options. He said, "You can either have stents or open heart surgery." So I said, "I'll have the stents." Mm. Anyway, so they did them there and then. They actually did the stents Friday afternoon while I was there.
That quick,
and I was home Friday night. So it was... I didn't, you know, when you don't have time to take stuff in, because it was that quick. Like Wednesday, I was in. Thursday, test. Friday, operation done and home. But this hospital up here, this Blackpool Vic, what an hospital! I mean,
they looked after you.
Oh mate, it's the first time I've ever been in hospital. Mm. I've never been in hospital. I'm 59, and that was the very first time I've been in hospital. And the staff, from the porters to the doctors, everybody, you know, absolutely wonderful, do you know what I mean? I can't, you know, you hear it all the time, don't you? "Oh, they've saved my life," and that, but I couldn't thank them enough, do you know? Absolutely brilliant, you know, and the NHS gets a lot of shit, don't it, off people and stuff like that, but...
No, when you need it, when you realise...
Well, for me, absolutely, what an amazing place. Not that you want to keep going back to it, like, but, you know, an absolutely amazing place. We're all right here, Chris. Yeah, it's an amazing place, and what a place. And they're supposed to be one of the best heart, cardiac hospitals there is. Yeah.
And nurses and doctors don't get the...
No, did they? Yeah. No. But brilliant, you know, everyone. Anyway, so like I said, it was that quick. You know, in the morning they said, "Oh, you might have angina." And I phoned Brian, I text Brian, I went, "Mate, you know them pains in my chest, they think it's angina." And he went, "What do you mean you're growing a vagina?" I went, "You dick." Anyway, that was just before they told me that I'd had a heart attack, you know what I mean? And he felt really bad about it, right? This lane here, Chris.
See the tower there.
Yeah, but it was just that, it was just, I'd been like just working through it, thinking it was indigestion.
How do you feel now?
I feel great.
Do you?
I feel like I could run a fucking marathon.
Really? So it's, right.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's amazing. I mean, now that they told me what it was and things that was happening, like, it makes you think a little bit more, you know what I mean? Yeah. Yeah, like, oh yeah, it wasn't indigestion, it was this, you know what I mean? Straight across.
It's good that you've caught it there though, isn't it?
Oh yeah, I mean, I find myself extremely lucky, you know, that that I found it, you know, we knew what it was and, yeah, and it was okay.
What advice did they give you regards to your lifestyle?
Just to take it easy for the first few weeks, you know, just don't go mad, you know, don't try and run any marathons or out like that, you know what I mean? But just take it easy and just eat. I mean, they told me to have 4 weeks off, but I'm not having 4 weeks off.
You're back in the gym and you're training,
yeah,
the lads.
Yeah, yeah. But I'm not doing anything crazy. I'm just overseeing stuff. We're going over there, mate. I'm just overseeing stuff, you know what I mean?
And yeah,
I'm only doing a few little one-to-ones and stuff like that, Chris. I've not got the body belt on or out like that, don't get me wrong, you know what I mean? Mm. Get behind this blue car here, Chris, because we're gonna go across there.
Yeah.
It's no room.
Down by the trams are.
Well, yeah, we're all right going down there, but there's a little car parking space there, but there isn't, is there? Mm.
It's pretty hard to park around here for old cars.
Yeah, it's like any town centre, mate. Yeah. It's murder, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? Yeah, so that was it. So this last couple of weeks has been pretty strange.
Yeah, I bet.
To be fair.
And everyone must have been getting contact when they...
Oh, yeah, I mean, well, we can park here if you want, behind this here. I'll see this.
Is this all right?
Yeah, it's all right here, yeah. We'll have to back up a bit better. But yes, so I mean, it's amazing, isn't it? You know, you when you get a little bit ill and you've got people phoning up and stuff and wishing you the well and that, you don't realise how blessed you are till something happens. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And because we're that busy going on with our lives, aren't we? Mm. We don't take time to think about all your friends and stuff like that. You know
look
I mean?
Well, but obviously, you say you've lost some weight.
Yeah.
Did you have to change your life? Did you?
No, no.
Did you have healthy? Do you eat healthy?
That was before, like, Chris. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, what the doctor said to me, he said, at a time like this, you need all the ace cards in your hand. So I don't drink, don't smoke. I've just lost weight, 2 stone. Done that, you know, myself because I wanted to. And I'm for a 59-year-old man with the job I do and racing pigeons, I'm relatively fit. I don't stop, do I?
Yeah.
From like half 5, 5:45 in the morning when I wake up, I'm active all day. Pigeons, boxing, back, you know, it's backwards and forwards, isn't it? You know what I mean? Yeah. So it's all helped me.
Yeah.
It's all been in, made all the odds stacked in my favour, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And then, like I say, I had the 3 stents done, and then afterwards, it's a real strange place, that, because it's not like an operating theatre anymore. It's like where they sit in Star Trek. You know, massive big screens on the wall and all computers, and then there's like a glass window, there's a bed, and then you've got a big, like, scanner over the top of you, what's taking pictures of your heart all the time. And these big screens along the wall, what you can't really see. And then there's a glass screen there, and there's loads of people behind with computers and that. Mm. You know, it's like space age.
It's always like,
yeah. Yeah, it's like, yeah, space age.
Yeah.
So afterwards, he said to me, the doctor, the surgeon, he said, come on, Mr. Rimmel, look, seeing is believing. And afterwards, finished, and he sat me up. He showed me a big blown up picture of my heart with the 3 blocked blood vessels, and then another picture of my heart with the blood vessels all open. So it was like mad, you know what I mean? Mm. It's like bleeding hell, do you know what I mean? It was like a real surreal experience, yeah, do you know what I mean? It's like,
can't get your head around it still.
Well, it is what it is now, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, it's done and dusted now, everything's okay, but I'm like, I never had time to think, You know, there wasn't, you know, I'm thinking, fucking heart attack, what are you on about? Indigestion. You know, because in my mind, it was solely indigestion. Mm. Even when I was doing the pads with the lads and stuff, I was like, ugh. But it was, I'm thinking, oh, it's indigestion.
It's your heart crying out.
Yeah, it was my heart saying, come on, fella. But yeah, so, you know, all's well that ends well, innit? Yeah. So, now that I've kind of lost this weight as well, so I'm gonna now start doing a little bit of training myself.
Right.
Nothing crazy, but I can't. I've got to start doing a bit of walking, and they give you the plan what to do. Mm. I'll be better than that, than the plan. You know what I mean? Because I'm relatively fit. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
I'm moving about all the time, anyway.
Yeah.
Well, talking of fit, we're gonna go and go in the gym.
Yeah, we'll go and see. We'll go and see the gym. The Lions gym.
The Lions gym. Let's go in, then we'll go and see the pigeons later on.
Yeah, yeah, cool. We'll see it all, mate. Yeah, we'll have a day. We'll have a full day.
Let's do it. Gym. It's a great gym. I've not been for a while. I remember I came there on the opening night,
weren't you?
Yeah, but it's not changed much. It's a great space.
No, I'll give you the walk around and let you see. So this is going to be like a little shop where he's going to sell protein drinks and coffees and teas and stuff like that.
That wasn't there last time.
Oh, and that wasn't. That's the reception. What is that built?
Lonsdale belt there.
Yeah, that's the it's a replica. That don't get excited.
It's
a replica of the belt.
You got it putting it in a frame or something for the wall?
No, I don't know what he's doing with it, mate. I don't know. So obviously this is the main gym. This is where we kind of do the circuits and.
It's big, that ring, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
What
yeah.
is it that 20?
It's a full-size competition ring. This is the Lion's office.
Oh, right.
He's got his own office now, he's made it. Made it now, that's the Lion's office.
Can I have him clothes? He's living in here, huh?
No.
The training gear.
Yeah, he's got his training stuff.
How is it, Bri?
Good.
Yeah,
it's
good. Okay, yeah?
Yeah, it's good, it's good.
He's well, that's catch up with him. Might be about, aren't you?
Yeah, it might be about after. He's just got the kids back in school, hasn't he? So, you know, he misses the kids that much, you know, when he's training.
Yeah.
So when we're not in training, he spends so much time with the kids as much as possible. He takes them to school, picks them up from the school. He's a proper dad, you know what I mean?
How was he, Bri, after the Anthony Fowler fight? Has he?
All right. That's the massage room. Got a lad who works there, Barnes. George Barnes, really good.
Yeah.
This is like a little weight section. A little. Put one of them on in a bit, Chris, and get in the ring if you want.
Mm. You see me eating that bag, Bobby, hit it twice a bracket.
And then there's another. Let me turn the lights on, mate. So then there's another room here, what people use for doing one-to-one classes and stuff. It's like a little function room.
Okay, yeah. So you can do all the little classes and...
Yeah. This is the kitchen. It's got everything, hasn't it? It's got... So it hopes to be... This kitchen is going to be finished soon, fully functional. And it hopes to be doing food and stuff from here, so...
Oh, it's great. So obviously Brian's training here all the time when he's not in.
Yeah.
Well, he's here. He trains here when he's in camp.
Yeah.
And he does classes. You're doing one-on-one classes as well.
Yeah, I do one-on-one classes. Anybody who wants to.
It's massive.
Yeah, there's loads of room, isn't there? Showers.
changing rooms and toilets, lockers.
Thought of it, he's thought about it, hasn't he?
Yeah, absolutely.
Do you know what I mean?
So, I mean, how long ago was it when it opened? I can't, 3 or 4 years, would you say?
Would you say four years, Chris?
Must be. I'd have to have a lot more. Did he hit the ground running with the gym?
It took
a bit to build up. And
yeah, he's had to build it up from the word go. Do you know what I mean? He's had to put the work in. You know, he's had to graft, hasn't he? But now, see, with Brian, he's been training for a fight, and then he's been putting everything into the gym, and then training for a fight. You know what I mean? So. Now, he'd be able to have a good go at the gym for a bit till he thinks what he's doing, you know what I mean? Till he decides on what he's doing.
So it's not the last we've seen of Brian Rose, Bob?
No. Whatever he decides, it's up to him, isn't it, Chris? I mean, that's a decision for the fighter to make. You know, coaches and family and friends can only suggest something, but it's up to the fighter to make that decision. Do you know what I mean? Even the loss to Anthony Fowler, it was another good performance, wasn't it? You know, even though he got beat, he showed he's still got what it takes, hasn't he? So it's up to him, innit? You know, it's not like any of the fights he's been beaten, he's been knocked out or he's been stopped or he's been hammered. He hasn't, has he? Do you know what I mean? It's like, so it's a decision for him.
How did you go into the fight with Fowler when you was offered it? And well, you're supposed to be fighting Fitzgerald first.
We should have been fighting Scott Fitzgerald first, and then Scott hurt his hand, and then they offered us the Anthony Fowler fight. But to be fair, I wanted him to box at light middleweight. You know, I said Anthony Fowler's too big. Them are the people that are beating Brian, the big strong kids. You know what I mean? And so I didn't really want him to. What if it had the Fowler fight at 11 stone? Because we could have done 11 stone easier. That was the plan, to fight at 11 stone. But obviously they offered him the Anthony Fowler fight, and he took it. So, you know, you can't cry over spilt milk. You've just got to, that's the way it is. It was just my opinion that not to take the fight, but he did it. And he gave a good account of himself again. And that's the hardest part, isn't it? You know, that he keeps giving a good account of himself even when he gets beat. You know, like, so it certainly wasn't a career-ending fight, was it?
No.
You know, not that he's looking for that, but it wasn't, was it? You know what I mean? It's just, you know, Brian's no good against some big middleweights. And Anthony Fowler's a big, strong middleweight, you know what I mean? He's a big, strong kid.
He'd have no problem by still making light middle. He's comfortable enough.
Could have done it easier. Yeah. He could have done it easy. Don't forget, we was training from January, weren't we? We was in America, weren't we?
Yeah.
So he was training. He fought the kid at Liverpool, Jonathan. I can't remember his name. And Brian, the kid was 11-9. Brian was 11-2. You know, and then a couple of weeks before the Anthony Fowler fight, Brian was like 11-1. So he could have done it, you know what I mean? It just wasn't meant to be, was it? So, but they offered Brian a fight and he took it, so you can't moan after. You know, he's not moaning, it's me. I was the one who was moaning, saying, you know, it should have been at 11 stone, but...
You just see now if what the fight offers come in for him and
yeah, well,
see
that's what he'll do. It's up to him now, isn't it?
It's a good fight, good money.
I mean, if they offered him a good fight, good money, he'd probably take it, won't he? Mm-hmm. You know, but he won't, you know, I don't think he sees himself going back to six rounders and stuff like that. But, you'd have to ask him about that. It's only my opinion. My opinion is that he's not finished by a long shot, you know what I mean? But it's whether you want to keep doing it, isn't it? It's whether he wants to keep doing it and whether, you know, everybody wants to keep doing it. Yeah. It's very taxing, isn't it? Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely. If he's still got it, feels he's still got it, he knows best.
Yeah, he knows better than anybody, yeah.
Last thing
yeah.
about him is retiring and coming back in three, four years.
Only he will know that. Yes, yeah. You know, it's, nobody else will know it.
You mentioned about that even in America, you're over there quite a lot now, Bob. California, yeah. Training Rampage Jackson.
Yes.
I kind of know it sort of come about, he got you on board on that. But how are you finding it? You've been enjoying it, your time in America.
Fantastic.
Being involved in MMA and finding out about that. And
yeah, it's good, I'm learning bits about it. I mean, when I first went into it, I didn't have a clue. I didn't know what it was, you know, mixed martial arts. I didn't have a clue what it was, you know what I mean? I enjoy being with him. He's like a good friend, you know what I mean? He's a good mate, and I like being around him, and it's vice versa. You know, we got on great together. From the first time I met him, we got on great, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so it's like a holiday when I go over there sometimes, you know what I mean? So.
How it come about, he was fighting an ex-pro boxer who was really good, and he got you on board to
help him. Chris, he was training in England, fighting, he had a fight in Chicago, but against a bloke called Glover Tierra. So I was training him down at my gym at the Phoenix camp then, a Better Bodies down there. And
how did you meet?
His manager at the time rang me and asked me would I mind training him. So they brought him to the gym, and I got chatting to him. We, you know, started working with him then, and we got on really well. Mm. So it kind of went from then on. I think that was about 8 years ago. So when it was logistically possible, and I went training the pros, I went over and helped Quinton. You know what I mean? And then I've helped him a lot just recently.
What's it like over there and staying over there, California?
Great.
Okay. Good time.
Yeah, it's good. I mean, you've got to work, you know, you have to work hard. And but over there, it's different than here. You're part of a team. You have a wrestling coach, an MMA coach, you know, so you're part of a team. It's not just you. Do you know what I mean?
So he does a bit of stand-up, a bit of...
Yeah, well, there's so many different things. He's kickboxing, he's kicking, he's jiu-jitsu, he's wrestling, you know, he's all different.
So how would a typical MMA boxer train a session if he's got all these different coaches? And how long would it be? And,
you do different sessions on different days.
Okay.
You know, you'll do your stand-up on one day. But he loves boxing. You know, he could be a boxer if you wanted. He could be a professional. He's got really good hands and his feet, and he's very powerful, do you know what I mean? I train him
as well. He must be good, though.
Yeah, so he's got to be good. So, but he's really good. It's always been a love of his boxing. He's always fancied having a pro fight.
Do you think he'll give it a go?
He's one of them. If they offered it to him and the money was right, he'd take it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Any plans to go over again in the near future?
Yes, October I'm going over.
Right.
Yeah, I'm going back.
He's got a fight coming up.
I'm not sure yet, but I'm just going to go over and see him and have a little see how he is in that first.
Yeah.
Find out what's going on there.
Good. What are the you know, going forward for you as a coach? You've not like you say, you're doing your one-on-ones. You've got Brian.
Yeah, I've not.
Shall we sit down?
Yeah, I've not. I'm like at a bit of a crossroads.
Yeah.
Especially with what's just happened. I'm 59 now. So to take a young kid on, a new pro, I don't know if I've got the heart to do all that again. To go through all that, you know, it's a 5-6 year job, isn't it?
Through the four rounders again.
All the way through all that again. And
the commitment,
you know,
it takes.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm very lucky. I help your Steve out in the corner with Terry, and I do the corner with Terry, and I help our Rob out sometimes. So for me, I don't think I've got that ambition to train fighters for competitive fights anymore. Do you know what I mean? I don't think I've got that anymore. Do you know what I mean? As far as it goes with Brian, I said I'd be with Brian till the end, and if Brian ever needs me, I'll always be there for him. You know, he's like a son to me, and I'd never let him down, never. I'd never let my son down, and I'd never let your Steve down, you know. But I think as far as it goes for me to take a young fighter on and start again, you know, up and down the country, taking him sparring and, you know, being like a father to him, because that's how I do things. I don't think I've got that anymore.
Chris.
It seems like you've got a good balance there, though, the way you're doing it with Brian. You're doing the, you're still involved in the gym every day, doing that bit of cut, and then you're doing a bit with Rampage.
Yeah, of course,
So it's kind of a nice sort of lifestyle.
I'm in a good place at the minute, and I've got my pigeons as well. So, you know, I'm in a good place. You know, I can come and do some classes and do a couple of classes here for the lads and for Brian and his partner Dan Coyle. I've got it easy. Not easy, but you know, there's no stress at the minute because Brian's not in the gym. but it's just nice and easy. Do you know what I mean? I don't think I've got that ambition to start again. Do you know, it's a lot of commitment in it. Do you know, I don't think I've got that.
There'll be some memories on that wall there, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, all the posters. I think that's the first time I met Brian. Now, just before that, Max Maxwell fight.
Yeah, the second one.
So that was his debut.
No, that
one there, Wally Dixon.
Yeah, he fought
Wally Dixon. Grant Promotions.
Grant Harvey fought there, 2006. Where's that gone?
Grant Harvey.
13 years ago.
Lee Blundell there. Mm.
Jeff Thomas, he's a coach here now, Jeff.
How is he?
Yeah.
Rose Webb, I remember that. Was that that one? That was at the. Round here, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was at the Winter Gardens. That's when he won the title outright. Got a tough fight, that.
Yeah.
Good fighter, Sandler.
He was, wasn't he?
Yeah, real good fighter.
Andrade versus Rose, the world title fight. Mm. How long has that seen ago?
2014. That's Prince Adam when he won the British title.
Do you remember when we made that video, The Prince and the Lion?
Yeah, good video that, wasn't it?
Yeah. You look back at the quality of it, it was terrible with the camera and that, but the content was good, wasn't it, what we did?
I think that was his, he got a bad injury in that fight there. He got a real bad injury. He got a trapped thoracic nerve under his shoulder, he was out for a year after that. And that was his first fight back there. You know he bought a set, he bought Eddie Smith, you remember Eddie Smith?
Yeah, I went to
see Ernie Smith killed himself, didn't he? Ernie Smith, remember?
Yes.
They both killed themselves, didn't you, man, his brother?
Yeah, that's from the Midlands, that was tragic,
tragic.
The old lad there, that's when you...
Yeah, that was when he beat Maciel.
Yeah. Stephen.
Yeah.
Kerry.
Yeah. Stephen's always done the corner with his hand, Kerry. And that was our Rob, just getting involved then, do you know what I mean? Yeah. Tell by his hair, quite our Rob then, too.
Yeah, Rob's doing the coaching, he's...
doing great.
He's up at the old gym you was at.
Really proud of him, yeah. Yeah. It's really good to see what he's doing.
He's got some good talent.
The new Phoenix camp, he's called it.
Yeah.
The new Phoenix camp. But yeah, there's plenty of history on that wall, mate.
I mean, I suppose, you know, if a young Mike Tyson walked in that door, you know, when you got that little feeling again a bit and thought, you know, this lad's got some, you know, someone who was dedicated.
Yeah, this women's boxing's really good now. I could probably do it someone who's not too taxing. You know, not too taxing on the body, do you know what I mean? Like, with the pads and the body belt, that's what I do, that's my thing. Pads and the body belt, that's my thing, you know what I mean? So, you know, like a smaller kid or even a good girl boxer or, you know, a woman boxer or something like that, you know what I mean?
But, $1 million baby.
Yeah, something like that, get a chance at that. But to be fair, you know, like these big middleweights and light heavyweights and all that, I'm too old for them to be punching me about.
Knocking out your body on that.
Knocking out that body belt, you know what I mean? Yeah. But yeah, so, but then again, you know, I say, oh, you know, kind of want to get the commitment. But then all of a sudden, someone walks in the gym and it makes the hair stand on the back of your neck, doesn't it? Mm. And before you know where you're in it again, aren't you? You know, so...
That chapter, that book's not closed quite yet.
No, not yet, but I don't know.
Yeah. Well, we don't know what Brian's doing yet, so you're still well in it at the moment.
Still got the lighting, haven't we?
You mentioned female boxing then. It's amazing how much it's come on the last few years, isn't it?
It took off fantastic.
Back to the days of Jane Couch. Yeah. You know, we remember how difficult it was for Jane and how boxing looked upon.
I mean, Jane was the pioneer for British boxing, wasn't she?
Absolutely. Yeah.
You know, and I remember her doing an interview when me and Barks was doing that show. She came down and did that boxing show with us, and she was telling us, like, you know, she went away to fight for the world title and she was sleeping on a casino floor. They didn't even give her a fucking room, you know what I mean? And so she was a pioneer, wasn't she, Jane? You know what I mean? And there's only one Jane Couch, isn't there?
Absolutely. She's got a book out.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to reading it.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to
it. I'm going to try and go up and catch up with her.
Yeah, it'll be good. Yeah. Be good, because she's out of the way. Where is she? Portsmouth?
Bristol, I think she lives in.
Bristol somewhere. Can't go any further. You fall off the end, don't you?
Yeah. We spoke a couple of times on messages, and we've always said to myself, I need to make the time.
Oh, she's great, Jane, isn't she? You know, I mean, she did a bit of interviewing for a bit, didn't she? She was doing like a bit of a show.
Early days, she was one of the first to do it.
Yeah, but like I say, she was a pioneer in England of women's boxing, wasn't she?
Yeah.
She kind of brought it to the fore, didn't she? And she only trained up here, didn't she, Fleetwood?
Yeah, she's from Fleetwood, isn't she?
She's from Fleetwood, yeah. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, from where it's gone now to now, from then to now, it's gone so quick, hasn't it? It's changed so quick, you know what I mean?
And when there seems to be a female on most shows now. When you see a female fight, you don't really look at it as something, you just see it as a boxing fight now.
Yeah.
Do you?
It's just a fight now, isn't it? Yeah. It was a bit of a spectacle in the beginning. But now it is what it is, isn't it? You know, you've got a lot of young, good girls coming through Manchester now, haven't you?
Yeah, you know,
like Savannah Marshall and people like that, and you know, they're all kind of coming to the front now, aren't they? But it's the same in football, isn't it? I mean, you know, with the women's football's come to the front, hasn't it?
I enjoyed the Women's World Cup.
I mean, we're in that age now of equality now, aren't we? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And fair play, you know, it don't matter what sex you are, what race you are, or it don't matter, get in, and if you want to do something, do it, innit? You know what I mean?
Do you remember them days, or you imagine in the 70s, 80s, a girl walked in the gym, and I think Jane had said when she walked into Collier's, and Brian Hughes was like, she can't train in it, and Pat, I think, you know, let's go a different era, you know, the 80s.
Yeah, I mean, when we was down there, there was a girl, Laura Kelly.
Laura, yeah.
She would come training with the lads.
She was good, wasn't she?
Yeah. She's real good amateur. She knocked loads of people out, but Laura came training at the gym with us. And it was like really strange in the beginning, but it's just the same, you know. You know, they all believe the same in the ring, don't they, when they get the nose cut and stuff like that, you know what I mean? So, you know, fair play to him, fair play to him. But it was Jane Couch, wasn't it, she was the first, wasn't she?
She was the first lady of boxing.
The first lady of boxing. There's tons of history. Do you remember them when they started having them dinner shows at Old Trafford? Remember they only ever had one, didn't they? Do you remember?
Yeah.
That one there. I think it was, what was he called, that manager? Tom. He used to manage Gomez and all them. What was he called? Tom Gomez and all them, his manager was called Tom. Can't think of his name. His son put them his show on. A belting show. It was the only ever one that was on there. The only one that ever happened.
At Old Trafford.
Yeah. Thriller over dinner, yeah.
Carson Jones, two fights he had there with him.
Yeah. I mean, you like Maxwell. I mean, Maxwell knocked Bry out the first time, and then Bry come back and beat him up, didn't he? And same with him. He stopped Brian in the first round, but it was a bit controversial, the stoppage.
Yeah.
And
that's when he run from the ring, Brian, wasn't he?
Yeah, went mad, yeah. Kicking all the tables over and all that.
Yeah, he wasn't happy.
And then he came, and then he took a big pay cut to fight Carson Jones again and beat him up in Hull.
Yeah. He just wanted that fight, didn't he? He just wanted to lay it to rest.
Yeah, he beat him up in Hull, yeah.
What's the most memorable moment? You've had a few with Brian. What was the one that always sticks in your head and is what you remember
I think when he beat Prince Aaron, when he won the British title, when he beat Prince Aaron, that was one of the great nights, you know what I mean? And obviously I know it didn't go our way, but when he fought Andrade, you know, kid from Blackpool, top of the bill at the Barclays Centre in New York. Yeah. Not bad, is it?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
I remember you said you sat in the A&E in downtown there.
Yeah, it was really frightening. Well, they just dropped us off at the A&E, and there was people chained to handcuffed to chairs and that, you know, drunks and that, and
me and Brian was just sat there like, fucking hell. I'm doing all right in America now, I know it like the back of my hand, but then I was like a rabbit in the headlights, you know what I mean?
Do you enjoy America, Bob? Do you like the lifestyle there?
Yeah, I like it.
The Americans?
It's good. I get looked after. I get really, really well looked after. Do you know what I mean? So,
what's boxing's massive, isn't it? It always has been. I mean, at the moment, it seems more than ever.
Yeah, it's made a massive comeback, hasn't it?
Yeah. What's it like over there? I mean, is that many sports?
Huge.
Is boxing still big there?
Yeah? I mean, there's gyms everywhere. You know, there's boxing gyms everywhere. Everywhere you go, there's a boxing gym.
Yeah.
You know, and there's little boxing shows on every Saturday night. You can go to three or four boxing shows every Saturday night, you know what I mean?
So even though they say so nationally in America, it's not, you know, you've got American football and all baseball and all this.
It's just that much bigger of a country. So there's more going on. Because look at us here in England, it's a little small country. But America's huge, isn't it? You know, and there's a lot more going on, that's all.
Have you ever thought about moving out there?
No.
Altogether?
No.
You couldn't leave Blackpool.
I couldn't leave my family, could I? I couldn't. I've got so much going on here, haven't I? You know, with Shannon, and Shannon's got an horse, and we've got the dog, and we've got the pigeons, and I've got all the kids and my grandkids. You know what I mean? I'd never be able to do it. I'd never be able to do it.
Bob over now and again, and that's nice.
Yeah,
so,
it's good.
Yeah. Well, Bob, shall we go and get back in the car, drive down the
we're on the front promenade. You want one of them kiss me quick hats, don't you?
I do, yeah, man, donkeys and that.
Go for a ride on the donkeys.
Let's do it.
We're going to go straight down there.
So 1981, Bob, you turned pro.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Till 1985, four years of pro.
Yeah. Then I realised there was more money in the back of security vans.
There's one there. Are we all right going down here?
Yeah.
Take us back to that then, turning professional, Bob. Where was you in your life at that
point? I was... 1981, and how old was I? 76. I was 21, wasn't I?
21.
No, I was 16 in 76, and then 1980. So I was 21, yeah. And I was boxing. You know what? My mate was Carl Bailey. We was pals, me and Carl Bailey, and Carl Bailey was a pro anyway. And Steve Coleman, the three of us used to train together. And I was boxing at Ardwick Lads then. And Steve Coleman was. We're going to do it right there. And I don't think it was like we just turned pro and then go to the bottom there and do it right.
Right?
Yeah, do it right here, yeah.
I thought we'd be over that end, yours.
No, it's down.
It's like north.
Yeah. So I just turned pro. Mm. I'd like 14 fights, didn't I? And then found another way to earn money.
What was it like, the pro circuit in Manchester? Was it like Nat Basso and
Jack Trickett, Jimmy the Weed, Brian Robinson, you know, they kind of brought boxing back to Bellevue, didn't they?
Mm.
You know, we fought at Bellevue where they brought the boxing back, so great times, great days, you know what I mean?
I remember you telling me a story about... they were opening a pub, the Brown Cow, somewhere in Colliers, I think it was.
Well, no,
they brought a Brown Cow.
Yeah, a Brown Bull. It's called the Brown Bull, yeah.
Brown Bull.
It was Jimmy the Weed's pub, that.
Mm.
Right in town, fucking right in bottom of Deansgate. And they brought the Brown Bull in. Watch him, this sausage here, look.
What's that, his pub?
Fucking don't know. So there's the Blackpool Sea there,
yeah.
Pal.
Turn the lights on recently, didn't they?
Yeah, yeah.
Did it not get you to do it, Bob?
No. You might get me to put them out. Brian's turned the lights on.
Yeah.
Yeah, he switched the lights at one point.
How were him and Jack Armfield? The last time.
Great, old pals.
Do you know what? Last time I was there, I was driving. I met Brian in a restaurant there.
Yeah.
But I'd interviewed Jack prior.
The beach
got up and down here, and he dropped me off. I walked out of the car and went to see Brian.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Talking to him. Yeah.
Everybody, we're all friends again now.
I'm glad to hear
do
that.
Do you know what I mean, Brian?
Glad to hear that. Yeah.
And you know what? The other day when I come out of hospital, Jack rang me, and you know what? I was fucking over the moon when he rang me. Do you know what I mean? Yeah, I was really pleased when he went, hi mate, it's Jack Armfield. And I'm like, hi Jack, how are you, mate? And I could hear the baby on his knee, and he really sounds like he's changed, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He's got a new baby, and his outlook on life's obviously changed now, hasn't it? You know what I mean? And, you know, he's had his problems and stuff, but he's a father now, so things, your outlook on life's different when you become a father, isn't it? But it was great to speak to him, really nice to speak to him, you know what I mean?
Glad to hear that.
And there was at some wedding the other night, and Brian and Jack was there, and they were having the pictures took together and that, so great. It's really good, isn't it? Great. You know,
it is good, yeah.
Listen, the heat of battle, you know what it's like.
Yeah.
The heat of battle, so.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was absolutely over the moon when I spoke to him. Remember when your mum used to bring, your dad used to bring you to the lights, you remember?
Mm.
When we was kids. Hey.
It was usually like a friend's mum and dad.
Our White's lemonade, remember it?
Yeah, Our White's.
Them little bottles of Our White's lemonade, wasn't it? The best lemonade in the world.
My first memory of, or my vision of Blackpool when I think of coming is the slot penny things.
Yeah,
the tipping point.
Yeah.
That's how they made a show out of it now.
Well, this is, we're going out of it now. This is where I live, in it, Bispham, which is up
there. It's nice, isn't it? Is that?
It's a bit quieter, to be fair. Crazy down there, isn't it?
Yeah. But you're enjoying the Blackpool.
Oh, it's great. It's great.
I was saying, do you get to the sea, but you get the wind blow through you?
No, well,
it's on your doorstep.
When I take the dog out, I go up. I don't come down. I did used to take her on the beach here. But like I said, there was them signs up saying that there'd been palm oil olive on the beach and it's bad for the dogs, isn't it? You said you seen it up for me, didn't you? So, and in the summer, when it's holiday season, I don't think you can take the dogs on the beach.
Any boxing this weekend? What have we got?
I don't know. My highlighter this weekend is I've got three pigeon races.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, I sent to 2-1 loft races. I've got some pigeons in the RPRA 1 loft race, and I've got some pigeons in the Pride of the Potteries 1 loft race, and then I've got my own club race on Saturday, and we've got the file 2 bird race. So I've got 4 races weekend.
How does a pigeon race work?
Well, we take them to our club, our pigeon club, and we mark them, and we put all the pigeons in a big basket. They go in big baskets, and then a big transporter wagon picks all the baskets up, takes them all to the race point, and lets them all go at the same time.
And it's the first one home,
yeah. Yeah, first one back.
Do you have like first, second, third?
All the way down, yeah. Yeah.
And what do you get if you win? Your pigeon wins?
Well, on a Saturday, your club racing, it's more performance racing, you know. You win cards and stuff like that.
Okay.
But the big races, that Pride of the Potteries, I think if you win that, you get 15 grand or something.
All right.
And the RPRA one, I think that's 25 grand.
Mm.
And you can win a new card as well, stuff like that. So
I think when my granddad used to do it, they didn't have prizes like that.
No, they never used to. I mean, look at your Steve, Big Steve.
Well, they're big into it, aren't they, our Steve?
Yeah, I mean, look at Big Steve. He wins. He's probably one of the best young bird flyers that's ever come out of Manchester. You know what I mean?
Really, is it?
Yeah.
He keeps that quiet.
Oh, he's that good, mate. Honestly,
he's that good. Young Stephen, who does the boxing coaching,
Yeah.
I don't know if he's got any at the moment, but he has done. He's brought up with it.
I think he does the breeding. So at these lights, we're going to go right, Chris.
Okay, well. Is that how you met Stephen? Because of through pigeons?
Yeah, through pigeons in the early days. And boxing, do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
and then And then young Steve, when he was turning pro with Terry Flanagan and Carl Place, they came and used my gym. He was with us for about 3 years.
Yeah.
It was great. Great.
You've been in most of the corners with
Yes. Well, Steve's always done the corner with me and Brian, and I've always done the corner with Terry and Steve.
Yeah.
I knew Orleans and all that with him, didn't I?
And did you know them all from Ann Coates and Hardwick and...
Yeah, that's
how... they were your uncles. And
yeah, we knew them all, yeah. Yeah.
Joshua Ruiz, did you see they've just done a press conference in...
Yeah, yeah.
What do you think about that rematch over there? What did you think of the first fight?
I thought Joshua got it on the head, on the top of the head, and when that happens, it's over, isn't it? But he wasn't right, was it?
Didn't look right, did
it? It didn't look right, but you've got to remember this, Ruiz played a big part in winning that fight, didn't he? Do you know what I mean? Whether you're right or not, he still had a fight, didn't he? But I remember him saying to, what's it in the corner? Why am I feeling like this? But you get it on the head off them big men, you know, it sends you funny, doesn't it?
One where he got caught, and then he got caught again behind the ear as well.
Yeah, that's what I mean, on the back top of the head.
Is that the one you mean?
Yeah. That's where all your balance
never is recovered
there.
After that.
That's where all your balance is behind there, isn't
yes.
it?
What did you think? Did you stay up and watch the fight?
No, saw it the next day.
So like everyone else?
I don't do that anymore, Chris.
Do you not bother doing that though?
I don't do that anymore. Do you know that, like, staying up all night to watch the fight and then...
It was good when it was on ITV, but it was Tyson years ago in the 80s.
I remember going to watch Marvin Hagler against Tommy Hearns, at the Apollo Hardwick.
Oh, on the big screen?
Yeah, yes. Live by satellite.
Right, you watched it on there. I watched Tyson's comeback when he came out of prison.
Yeah.
I can't remember who we fought.
We're going over there, mate. Yeah.
Straight
over there, mate.
Yeah, they don't do that anymore, do they, with the big fights?
No. Well, everyone's got them, haven't they?
What do you think about the rematch with Joshua Ruiz, Bob? Do you think he can get his titles back?
You know what I always think about? Like, when someone wins a title off somebody and they have an immediate rematch, I think that the champion always comes back better. Goes back to the drawing board. Now, if AJ... boxes as well as he can box, I think he beat through his easy.
Just look at Chris on the right.
I think he'll beat Ruiz easy, but you know, we all thought that first time, didn't we?
Yeah. Fury Wilder 2 coming up as well. Yeah. Hopefully, if they can both get through
some big fights coming on in heavyweights, isn't there?
What are you looking forward to the most, Ruiz rematch with Joshua or Wilder Fury rematch?
Both of them. Yeah. I think the Wilder and Fury is going to be more. There's going to be more in it than there is the Ruiz and Joshua.
Yeah. Heavyweight boxing. Let's go see the Pigeons. Bob,
crazy in it.
Come on, lads. These are the stop birds. These are the. Just let me get them out for you. 1 second, please. Come on, boys. Come on, lads. Come on, boys. Yeah, I breed the babies and then I raise the babies in the other loft. Okay. But these are all specialised pigeons that I've bought, or most of these are from Holland, been imported from Holland. They're called Mandalarts. I've had pigeons since I was about 8. What happened was, on the park, when I was a kid, I found this pigeon on the park and it had like a metal ring on its leg, and I was intrigued by it. I thought, what's that? Anyway, I took it home and my dad said, oh, it's a racing pigeon. So we got a box and all that, so fed it, looked after it, let it go, went to school. Come home from school, it sat there on the box. So I ended up with it, and then that's what got me started. I was
letting out, I started off with like a couple of orange boxes, and then it got a bit bigger and a bit bigger, and before we knew where we was, I had about 20 pigeons in the backyard. We had a yard then, you know what I mean? And then we had an old air raid shelter in the back of our house. And then I had pigeons there in the air raid shelter. And it's just, I've had them ever since. There's never been a time when I've not had them. Just, this is a new loft, I've just had this built. I mean, we're very lucky here, we've got a big garden, haven't we? So,
goes back a bit as well.
Yeah, I've got another part there. I've nicked half the garden off Shadow. These are me, them are the breeders. And these are my racers here.
Have you built all this, Bob? All this?
No, you buy these lofts, don't you? And they come and build them. Come on. Come on, lads. Come on. Come on, boys. These have just been out playing round.
What do you get out of it? What's the personal satisfaction for you
The personal, it's like you've got to train them, haven't you? I've got to take them from here in the morning, put them in the car, take them 50, 60 miles, and then let them fly back. So it's a bit, and you've got to give them the best food. So it's a bit like training boxers, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? I've got to look after them, I've got to train them, I've got to give them the best food. You know, and you've got to train them to be good racing pigeons. These are exercising now for the day. These are young birds. Come on, I'll show you the young birds. These are what's going. They're not going to the race. These are going to the race on Saturday.
These are the number one top jollies here.
Yeah, these are the boys. Come on, lads. Warm in here because the eating's on. Can you feel it? So these, I've not cleaned them out yet. You have to clean them out twice a day, but obviously because you've come, I've not done them the second time. But these are the ones that are going to be racing at the weekend.
Better shut the door, Bob, or what?
Yeah, just shut the door, mate.
Not all these ones.
Yeah, so I'm hoping him, this fella here. I'm hoping this fella. I'm hoping he's going to do the business on Saturday, this lad. Remember that number, V19227. So I'm thinking this fella, him here, will do really well on Saturday.
What's his name? Has he just a
number? He ain't got one. He's just a number. Yeah, he's just a number at the minute. They don't get a name till they get really good. 19227. GB19V19227. He's bred out of two of my best pigeons.
Look out for this top prospect.
Yeah. He's bred out of two of my best pigeons.
Yeah, right.
And he's been knocking on the door every week. So the wind this week, the wind's blowing in the face. It's a north wind. So our pigeons fly home from the south. So the wind's the north, so it's blowing them back. So it's not an easy race, it's a tough race. So his parents was bred for that tough racing.
It's like the Grand National of pigeons.
Yeah, so I'm hoping he's gonna come through.
I wish you good luck, Bob.
Yeah, this fella. And where's the other one? I'm hoping. Where is it?
Got loads.
Yeah. Your Stephen picked one out the other week. Might be this. Yeah. This is one. Your Stephen was here, young Stephen. And he picked him out. Number 33. And We went to the race and we had a real bad race in the Bamford race. Everybody struggled to get the birds home. So this week he'll be on the money. I think this week.
You're tipping him for big things.
Yeah, I hope so. All of them. I mean, you know, this year's younguns and next year's yearlings, aren't they?
We like talking about boxers, aren't we?
Yeah, of course. These are doing four rounders at the minute.
Four rounds. Yeah,
next year they'll be in them world title fights.
And then in title contention, hopefully, a few of these. Any world champions, Bob, in this camp?
I hope so.
But he came back the other day injured, see, like... He came
back from a race the other day. All his legs smashed up, see it? All that was all cut open.
What about treating them? Do you have to?
I kind of do it myself. Stuff like that, I do it myself. But you can sort of stitch them up yourself. Everything's all right. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Is it relaxing, Bob, as well?
Yeah. Yeah, I love it in here.
Spending time in here.
Yeah. Every day. I mean, you've got to clean them out every morning, and clean them out every afternoon. Mm. You know, it's like, you know, it's really taxing. Come.
Your grand used to say to me, Grandad, you love them pigeons more than me.
Well, they are, yeah.
He's there all the time.
Not a lot of the time, they're right. a lot of the time, they're right. You know, you get a pigeon, man. You spend all the time with the pigeons.
Is it one of them sports, like boxing, once you're into pigeons, it's very hard to get out of?
Yeah. I can't not have them. You know, I just can't not have them, Chris, do you know what I mean? I mean, like, when you've gone, now I'll be in here, clean all these lofts out, scrape all the floors, change the water, let these out again in the afternoon, you know what I mean? So.
So, but these ones here in the bowls, Bob, are they laying eggs?
Yeah, they've all got eggs, these lot. Because we want them to come home quicker, so we do little sneaky things. Like, they only have two eggs, but I've put three under him. Yeah. He's got three under him. And like...
Him?
Yeah, the cocks are sat now. The boys sit in the day and the girls sit at night.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
That's interesting.
So, like, I've put a few more eggs under there, look, see. One, two, three, four, there's five under there. And they should only have two. But it makes them sit tighter. Because they've got more eggs, so they sit tighter, do you know what I mean?
Tricks of the trade.
Tricks of the trade, yeah.
When the bird lays the egg, Bob.
Yeah.
What's the time for it till it becomes?
It takes 18 to 21 days for it to hatch.
Okay.
So it takes from the egg being laid, it takes 18 to 21 days to hatch, and then in 4 or 5 weeks they're flying.
Well, that's quick.
The babies are flying. Yeah. Yeah. I'll show you some babies. Come on.
That's a baby pigeon.
You never see them, do you? But you've never seen them, have you?
Never see baby pigeons.
You know why? Because they're always in the nest. You don't see them till they're fully feathered.
Okay.
They don't leave the nest till they're fully feathered, do they?
Right.
It's called Rocky him.
Rocky.
What?
Oh, he's a fighter.
It's because I'm going near his eggs.
Yeah.
Go on, Rock.
We don't want your eggs, really. So generally, you'll try and name him, but sometimes he's not many.
Yeah, I call him Rocky because he's daft.
Well, Bob, thanks for showing us the pigeons. It's been
good. My pleasure, mate. My pleasure.
In fact, it's great to see you today. It's great to see you looking well as well. That's the main thing of it all.
Yeah.
You know, you're shocking everyone there, worrying everyone. But Bob, no, thanks for today. It's been Chris, great to see you, as always. You
know. Always good to see you, Chris. Thank you very much.
Yeah, and thanks for the lesson on pigeon keeping.
That's it, yeah. Pigeon keeping.
You look after yourself, Bob. We'll catch up again soon.
Okay. Thank you, Chris. All the best, mate. God bless. Thank you.